want to start with our prayer request. Does anybody on this side have a spoken request? Okay. Anybody else? What about this side? Any spoken request? Any unspoken? Okay, I'm going to ask them to stand and pray over these requests. Get answers to come out.
Praise the Lord. Let's stand at your feet tonight. Let's worship the Lord. Amen. Aren't you glad He's alive? Amen. Can we give the Lord praise tonight? Amen. It's good to be back in the house of the Lord. Amen. Long journey. We went over 1,001 miles. But it's nothing like being back where we feel like home, right? Amen. Let's worship the Lord tonight.
Jesus is alive.
Praise tonight. Look over to somebody and say, because he lives, we can face tomorrow. Amen. Because he is alive. He kept his promise. Amen. He said that he would lay down his life and he would raise it up again. Amen. We thank the Lord for his goodness and his mercy. Amen. Let's sing unto the Lord.
Because he lives, because I glad to be here tonight. We're going to pick it up for you just a little bit, little hints and tunes. Well, you can always find a steeple, a few religious people. Find the preacher on the front steps to shake at everybody's hand. A sign shaped like a Bible, saying summer revival. But there's many dead churches just to taking up the acres of land. What you need is a soul filling station. A full service open 24 hours a day. Just a pumping that high octane super salvation. 'Cause we're a heart out of gas, feeling for that fast getaway. And you can have the greatest choir, dress them all in long white robe attire, have a wall full of trophies showing off your softball team. But if your people ain't for praying, yeah, that's how many staying. 'Cause ain't nobody going up on no water down gasoline. What we need is a soul filling station. A full service open 24 hours a day. Just a pumping that high octane super salvation. 'Cause we're a heart out of gas, feeling for that fast getaway. And what we need is a soul filling station. A full service open 24 hours a day. Just a pumping that high octane super salvation. 'Cause we're a heart out of gas, feeling for that fast getaway. Yeah, we're a heart out of gas, feeling for that fast getaway.
Has come back or not, I am glad to be back. Amen. Praise the Lord. This praise the Lord that the Lord was sanctifying me. My wife does not respond to that. And the very fact that we survived 385 Columbia Traffic, Queensland Traffic. And the preacher did not lose his sanity, nor his sanctification. Although it was borderline. It was borderline. It was borderline. I will say, my wife made a comment one time, talking about a joke. That might be about what's happening. Chapter 6 of Romans, amen. My wife said, are you going to preach on something on Easter? And I said, well, you know the way this all worked out, that here we have in chapter 6, that is all about
the Lord's grace has led us to this point of chapter 6. Amen. I just thank the Lord for His goodness and His mercy. I really have enjoyed this. And thank you for the prayers. We traveled to Tennessee. I actually got to go ride by Lee University. Always dreamed of going there and never did go. Got to ride by and have my picture taken from the Dr. T.L. Lowry's ministry building. Sister Morgan, it was about 9 or 10 o'clock. I said, let's ride by there. I'm going to get out. You take my picture before I get soaking wet. It was raining. And I got my picture there. And then we made it back to the room and just had a wonderful time. I would love to tell you that it was very relaxing, but it was not. Lo and behold, we go into Cleveland, Tennessee, and their numbers have skyrocketed with COVID. So we kind of just stayed in the room most of the time, not taking any chances on going out and being around anybody. So we went to the wedding. Some of you are wondering how the wedding went. We took a lot of pictures. But the wedding party probably wished they had never booked that crowd of people because they wanted an outdoor wedding. And the mother of the bride had decided she wanted her to have an outdoor wedding. And so the rain would come, they would run everything back in the building. The rain would leave, they would run everything out of the building. The rain would come again, they run it back in the building again. And I started to just stop about halfway and said, when y'all make up your mind whether you want to go here or go there, just let me know. But it was a beautiful wedding. I felt sorry for the people having to run the stuff in and out. The funny part of it, before we get into the scripture, was I was just about done with the ceremony, and I could hear the rain coming through the trees. You ever heard one of those rains you hear coming down the street? You can hear it. It's roaring because it's no little light rain. This is big, big drops. I could hear it coming down the river, coming right toward us. And so it was really funny. They were standing there in front of me. I finished about half of my last paragraph where I was basically lecturing them about marriage and pronouncing a blessing over them. And I skipped about half of that. And I said, God bless you, and you may kiss your bride, and let's get out of here. And so they kissed. Obviously, we all run to the building, barely didn't make it there. But the first drop that hit this lady's head that had her hair fixed, probably with 2 gallons, I'm not going off on you, ladies, but 2 gallons of hairspray. Nothing was out of place. One drop hit her hair, and she said, I don't care if this thing's over or not. She got up and left. And when she got up and left, everybody else thought that was the cue to get up and leave. So I'm trying to corral it. Thank you for prayers, because I needed it. I'm trying to corral all of that. How many of you are excited about Sunday? I'm just excited of what the Lord's going to do. He has put a word in my heart. He has put a word in my heart tonight, and I am just excited. I'm just looking for somebody, maybe more than one, to get saved. That's my prayer, and I want you to join me, because I know there's some praying people in here, but I want to see somebody get saved. I want to see somebody get baptized with the Holy Ghost. I don't want to just come in here and have church. I want us to see God move. And the way y'all say, I watched the video of how He was moving in here Sunday morning, and I think that is just the beginning of what God wants to do. Not just the shouting and everything, but people laying in the altar, crying out to God, because Jesus is about to come back. And I really believe that with all of my heart. Would you stand for the reading of God's Word? I'm not going to be too long tonight, even though I got it built up inside of me. I just want to show you a few things from the Word of God tonight. And I just want to start with this first verse, and then that's going to be our entry point. But I want you to listen to this chapter, and I want you to hear what I say tonight. Because this chapter has been mispreached and mismanipulated, I guess the best way to say, who fit so many sermons that most people don't understand what Paul was writing, what God intended this. And I want to show you tonight through his grace and his mercy.
Paul says, what shall we say then? Shall we continue? That word continue there means increase in sin, that grace may abound. Over in verse 2. God forbid, how shall we that are dead to sin live any longer there? Help me pray tonight. Father, we thank you, Lord, for all that you're doing in the church. We thank you for what you're doing in our lives. Thank you for, Lord, the lives that are being touched and testimonies that are being given, that people that are writing me, that are telling me about the things that you are doing in their lives throughout this study of the book of Romans. Lord, we know that you're up to something. Your word will never return void. That through the knowledge of your word, faith is increased. And so, Lord, we just thank you for all that you're doing. And we ask that you would touch our hearts and lives in Jesus' name. And the church said, amen, amen. I want you to follow along with me tonight. And I want you to see this, because I want to bring some clarification to some things. Now, Paul has not changed his subject. Paul is still talking about salvation and sanctification. He has not changed. Sanctification, then, this is a reminder, meaning to be set apart. The nature of sanctification has two distinct actions, okay? The first action is mortification. That means deals with the putting off of the old man. In other words, it's the change that takes place. Vivification, and I know these are big words, and so I can spell them for you if you want me to, but they bring the meaning out of this. Means to die to sin, to live to righteousness. So what we're dealing with is the mortification, meaning deals with the putting off of the old man, and vivification means the putting on the new man. Maybe this would help clarify this word. Vivify means, as a verb, means to enliven. Now, I want you to see this. Enliven. Everybody say it with me. Enliven. In other words, when Jesus comes into our life, he enlivens us. He begins to show us by the new nature that we receive through him. He enlivens that to promote us to put off the old man. How many of you know that many people are still fighting the old man? If we didn't fight the old man, then nobody in here would get angry. Everybody would be perfect. There would be no need for grace anymore. But Jesus knew, and Paul in his writing by the inspiration of the Spirit, knew that you and I would have to fight the old man. Does that mean we're in sin? Does that mean that sin has domain? That's what Paul is going to explain to us tonight. So therefore, there is the dying to sin, and there is the living to God. Now let's get into this. He said, what shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? God forbid. How shall we live that are dead to sin, live any longer therein? And I'm going to read the first 7 verses. Know ye not that so many of us, as were baptized unto Jesus Christ, were baptized unto his death? Therefore, we are buried with him by baptism unto death, that like as Christ was raised from the dead, hallelujah, by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life. For if we have been planted together in the likeness of his death, we shall also be also in the likeness of his resurrection. Knowing this, that our old man is crucified with him, and the body of sin might be destroyed, that henceforth we should not serve sin. For he that is dead is free from sin. So what is Paul talking about here? Paul has not changed his subject matter. Paul is still dealing with the sin versus grace. Interesting note here is that in verse 1 is there is a theme of a lot of people today. Well, God knows my heart, so they continue a lifestyle of sin. How many people have you ever heard say that? God knows my heart. Isn't it interesting how a lot of times they say, God knows my heart, but they don't ever say what God knows about their heart. They say, God knows my heart, but they don't go any further. They say, God knows my heart, and they bow out of the conversation. They never say that God knows my heart and that my heart is with Him and that I am serving Him. They never say that. Very few times do you ever hear that. So Paul is saying to them, why are you continually trying to manipulate sin versus grace? Why would anybody that has tasted the grace and the mercy of the Lord Jesus Christ want to continue going down the road that they were on when He saved them? Why? I'm not going to give you an answer because I don't know. I've never understood why a person wants to continue to do those things. Paul responds, he said, God forbid, be it far from us to think of trampling on the grace of Almighty God. When we continue to sin when we have been set free, it's no other than walking on the grace of God. Now, I'm not talking about, and we'll get into this in a minute, I'm not talking about a one-time sin. I'm not talking about a failure every now and then. I'm talking about a continuous saying that I'm going to continue to sin because grace, I'm covered by grace. I'm going to continue to go out here and do all the things that I used to do, but I'm covered by grace. I confessed Jesus Christ one time, but me and my wife had a good talk about this. I confessed the Lord Jesus Christ one time, but I'm going to continue to go out and do and live like a heathen and keep sinning and keep living like the devil because grace is going to cover me in the end. That is trampling the grace of Almighty God. And to do so is very distasteful. It's very unchristian that you would want to continue to do something that He sets you free from. Somebody say amen. Note that there are none that live without sin. So we're not talking about those that, because John says if you say you're without sin, then you're a liar. So when we talk about sin, we all, God forbid, have tendencies because we're still fighting the old man. Situations hit us. We maybe haven't prayed like we should have. We haven't been coming to church like we should have. And we have a weak moment and something hits us. Everybody ought to say amen. Because there, nobody in this room, everybody look at somebody beside you across the aisle and somebody and look at them and say, you ain't perfect. Y'all said that with so much enthusiasm. That was your time to get at your neighbor. None of us are perfect. Thank God that those, here's the difference. Thank God that those who do not live in sin. In other words, they do not practice sin. See, there is a difference between practicing and living in sin and committing a failure, which is a sin. There's a difference in waking up in the morning and say, well, Lord, I want you to go ahead and forgive me because I know and I'm going to sin today. There's a difference there. I pray nobody does that in here. Don't wake up in the morning and set yourself up for failure. That's what you're doing. You're giving yourself free liberty to, oh, Lord, I know that I'm going to cuss somebody out today. So go ahead and forgive me. Lord, I know that I'm going to be near the liquor bar, and I know I'm going to take a drink today. So, Lord, you forgive me. Lord, I know I'm going to partake in this, and I know I'm going to partake in that. So, Lord, you forgive me. What you're doing there is you're setting yourself up one for failure, but you're also setting yourself up to trample the grace of God. I don't set myself up to go out into sin. I might have a moment when I fail God. I might have a moment when I let God down. But I don't intentionally go out. There's those who practice it, and there's those who make it the mistake every now and then. That's what Paul is talking about. Look at verse 3. The meaning that we have joined to Him, therefore, comes with privileges. A lot of people want to, I'm covered by grace. They take the privileges
but they leave out the obligation. Oh, let me preach there for a minute.
We all want the good, the privileges. I'm covered by His grace, and I'm covered by His mercy. We all want that, but there comes with those privileges, there comes an obligation. I told somebody the other day, and it may be here in the church, I told them, I said, I don't live right because the Bible tells me to live right. I live right because I'm obligated. I'm faithful. I'm faithful to my wife, not because I'm scared of a divorce. I'm faithful to her because I love her. Ever notice what Jesus said? Jesus said, if you love me, you'll keep my commandments. Not keep my commandments and then you'll love me. He says, if you love me, you'll keep my commandments. So we have privileges and we have obligations that are covered in grace. Obligation means as any duty imposed by law or purpose or contract. Therefore, we must comply with the design of His death, which is therefore that we may be set free from sin. Therefore, we must comply to die to sin. Paul's saying, you got to die to sin. This is true of our profession. If we have been set free from sin, then sin no longer reigns in our body. I don't set myself up. I don't go to places I know that that's going to cause me to sin. I don't go in situations where I know it's going to cause somebody to help me tonight. I don't put myself in those positions, in those relationships, and in those positions and out through life to set myself up that sin can reign in my body. Oh, hallelujah. We're going somewhere. So he looks at verse 4. And so he shows us the beginning of our vivification, meaning the process of enlivening. The newness of life is a result of the newness of heart. That's why the Bible tells us in 2 Corinthians 5 and 16, behold, you are a new creature in Christ Jesus. Behold, all things, the old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. Why? It's because everybody remember when you got saved. I don't know if everybody's experience is the same. But Sister Sanders, when I got saved, when I stood up from that altar, people looked different. The world looked different. Anybody else feel the way I feel? I didn't look at people the same as I looked at them when I went down as I did when I came up. When I came up, I walked outside. When I walked outside, the grass was even greener. The sky was beautiful because I had been set. Maybe it's not the same for everybody else, but because I had been set free, I had been changed. There was a newness in my heart and a good place, and the renewing of my heart enlightened everything. It enlightened me that He could love me while I was yet a sinner. It enlightened me that I'm supposed to love my brother and love my neighbor as myself. It enlightened me to see God in another way. It enlightened me to see that He loved me enough that He gave His only begotten Son for me, that He didn't put obligations on me down here. He really come up and said, I'm going to love you. You come into my arms. I'm going to love you. And it's with everlasting love that I have called thee. I saw things a lot different. I didn't look at the preacher's sermon as a drag anymore. I didn't look coming to church as a drag anymore. Somebody help me. I didn't look as coming to and being around church folks and didn't look at them and say, I don't want to be around all them holy people. I looked at it as it was a newness of life. I had been born again, washed in the blood, and I wanted to be changed because I've been changed inside. I wanted to make a change on the outside. Hallelujah. See, old things have to pass away. In other words, you've got to put the old way to death. Every morning you ought to take your foot and put your foot on top of the devil's neck and the old man's ways and hold him down and say, I dare you to get up. I dare you. Therefore, look at verse 5. Therefore, if we conform to His likeness through His death, we shall also by the power conform to the power of His resurrection. Through transformation.
See, when Jesus went to the cross, Jesus went to the cross as Jesus, the Son of God, but he was just a man. You hear me? He was just a humble servant of God. He didn't have no accolades, no titles. He never claimed to it. He would always tell them, don't let nobody know who I am. He would tell the devils, don't let nobody. So if he wanted fame and fortune to go to the cross, he could have got it at any time. But Jesus humbled himself and come obedient unto the death, even the death of the cross. So he went to the cross as a man. When he died on the cross, he died as a sacrifice, but he died as a man. He died in a plain form. Isaiah said that there was no comeliness that we should even look upon. There was nothing that, I feel the Holy Ghost in him. There was nothing that was desirable about him. Yet he was bruised for our iniquities. Chastisement of our peace was upon him. With his stripes that we are healed. I believe Saint ought to say hallelujah again. But when he went into the tomb, and for 3 days he laid in a borrowed tomb of Joseph of Arimathea. He laid in that tomb, but when he was resurrected, when he was resurrected, he was no longer that humble servant, that humble shepherd anymore. He became the glorified Son of the living God. He didn't look the same as he went down. You see, that's the thing about a baptism. When you go into a baptismal water, it is symbolic of you going down to the old, dying to the old, and coming up with the newness of life. Jesus died for all of our sins. All of our sins were placed upon his back, and he died on the cross at Calvary. But when they buried him in that tomb, hallelujah, he didn't stay in the tomb. And when he come out of that tomb, hallelujah, he come out as glorified Son of God and ascended back unto the Father, hallelujah, to presently sit at his right hand. What I'm saying to you is if we're going to connect ourselves to him, the very same thing must happen in our life. We must die to the old and be born into the new. We're no longer this person anymore. We're a child of the King. We're no longer this old sinner that's sin reigned in their body, but we have been set free by the newness of life that comes through Lord Shakakodalamahai, the Jesus Christ. You got to understand. You're not this person anymore. You got to let it, I don't know who I'm talking to, but you got to let it go. You're not this person anymore. You are a child of the King now. You've been washed in the blood. You are redeemed. You're covered by his grace and by his mercy. Can somebody give him a shout of praise? You see, the death on the cross was a slow, agonizing death. May I tell you that the mortification of sin in believers is not an overnight process? Two amens. Do you understand what I'm saying? It's not an overnight process. We're all still being worked on. I might not be out in the bars no more. I might not be smoking and them left-handed cigarettes and cigars and all that stuff anymore. I'm not walking around cussing like I used to cuss. Not walking around fighting everything that's on two legs. But there are still some things that he is working on in my life. One is learning how to handle traffic. He's been working on me a long time with that one, but I'm getting better. It's the
depends on where I'm at. You understand what I'm saying? Don't get discouraged because you're not as far along as somebody else. You got to hang in there long enough by the grace of God. Do your responsibility. Stay with your obligation to Jesus. And let me tell you, it's not an overnight process, but it is a process. And as long as He's still working on me, I'm happy with that. Because when it's all over, said and done, He will have made something beautiful out of my life. When He is dead, you are mortified. You're freed from the sin that reigned in your life. This occasion, look at verses 8 through 13. I'm going to have to hurry if I'm going to get this done. Now, as we be dead with Christ, we believe that we also shall live with Him, knowing that Christ, being raised from the dead, dieth no more. That have no more dominion over Him. I want you to hear that. And what I just said, if we're going to live in Him, we must do the transformation. So if Jesus' death has no more reign over Him, that means sin never had no reign over Him. The curse of sin is broken through Jesus Christ. You can have a let me just stop right here for just a minute. How many people believe in here that you can go all day without sin? Thank you, Sister Tim. Anybody else? Anybody else? I'll never call for a raise of hand. I'm going to call for a raise of hand. How many people in here believe that you can go all day? I'm going to be honest now. Can go all day without sin. How many of you believe you can go all week without sin? There are some people and some preachers that preach that there's no way that you can go without sin. That everybody sins every day. Baloney. A lot of people go, I'm one of them. I just sin every day. Just because I get frustrated with traffic, I'm not cussing them out. I'm just frustrated. It doesn't make me a sinner. Right? See, here's another thing, and I might get hung up on this a minute. What some people call sin, what does the Bible say about it?
Oh, he's so cute, man.
Everything that everybody else calls a sin, you better check the Word of God and make sure it's a sin before you start even confessing of it. Because a lot of people are telling a lot of folks today that this is a sin and that's a sin and that's a sin. I'm saying, I've never read that. And what's happening is you got one broad spectrum that's saying that everybody sins every day, and that spectrum over here is trying to, everybody's covered by grace, so you just do your own thing, and everybody's going to make it to heaven. But then you got this side over here that's telling everybody, oh, that's a sin, that's a sin, that's a sin, and that's a sin. And they're putting condemnation on everybody. And then you've got the middle. You remember the old saying? You got two sides of the story, and then you got the truth. This is why you need to know what the Bible says. Because not everything that everybody says is a sin. You see, even though the Bible talked about long hair and short hair in the Bible, it talked about makeup, it talked about all these things, nowhere in the Bible does it say it's a sin. Paul suggested to them, don't be as the Egyptians with plaited hair and jewelry and all this. It wouldn't be coming of them, but it wouldn't have seen. It just didn't look like it. Oh, you say you're opening that kind of rooms up, preachers. Let me go on a little bit further. Some people talk about alcohol. Is alcohol a sin? Absolutely. Well, Paul told Timothy to drink a little wine with your water and it will be all right. So everybody says, oh, everybody can drink a little bit because the doctor says put a little bit in your kidneys every now and then. But do you understand by studying the scripture what Paul was writing to Timothy about? The water at Ephesus was so bad that it was hurting his stomach. And he said, if you'll just take and dilute it with a little bit of wine and mix it in there, then it would clear the water up because of the alcohol content in it. And it would make it easier on his stomach to drink. But everybody twists that and say, oh, Jesus turned the water into wine. But did Jesus drink it? It's important for us to know what the Bible says. Don't rely on the media. Don't rely on TV preachers. Don't even rely on your pastor. Get the Bible out. Because, listen, the Word of God has power to change your life. The Word of God can show you how to live in freedom and no guilt, no condemnation. It will show you that everything everybody's saying is a sin, and then it will show you some things that nobody's saying is a sin is a sin. Verification is the change. To be changed is a matter of choice. We live through faith. Everybody in here has accepted Jesus Christ. How did you do it? You didn't see him die on the cross. So for me to mortify myself to be changed and be enlightened by vivification, I must believe that he is able to do it. Everything about the Christian walk is faith. If I don't believe I can change, I will never change. If you don't believe you can change, you'll never change. When I was fighting drug addiction and alcohol, I don't like to talk about it. But it took me getting to the point of rock bottom and saying, I have got to change. I want to change. I want to be different. I'm tired of living where I'm living. Oh, I feel the Holy Ghost. For you to live closer to Christ Jesus, you have to say to yourself, I'm tired of living here when he wants me to live here. I'm tired of being one step forward and two steps back. I want to be up here where I'm walking in freedom, where sin don't reign over me anymore. I'm walking in his grace. I'm walking in his mercy. I'm walking in his love. I've lived down here too long. I want to live up here where I come to church and the joy of the Lord hits me, where I wake up in the morning and I'm not just filled with so much of his love and of his mercy. Can it be that way, preacher? Can it be that way? I'll tell you, absolutely it can. But first of all, you've got to believe that he can do it. Hallelujah.
Last of all, I'm going to summarize all the way down. Verse 12 and 13, he said, your members can encourage you. Everybody hold both your hands up. Stick out your tongue. Like you're posing for one of those Facebook pictures. No, not the fish lips. All right, now you can put them down. Some of y'all were really funny with that tongue. These are our members. James says this is the most unruly of them all. But everything that you do in someone else is a matter of choice. I can put you down or I can lift you up. I can shake your hand or I can smack you up, you military too, or smack you upside the head. I can wake up in the morning and be happy even after I stomp my toe. Or I can choose, but I worry this is going to be another one of them days. My toe is just, I'm starting off getting a cold coffee maker won't come on. Watch dropping about. Oh, I'm sorry. But you have the choice of what day you're going to have. You say, well, what about my circumstances? Your circumstances can't steal your joy unless you give it to it. Can't steal my salvation unless I give it. See, everything that you do with your members, whether it be your heart, your mind, your tongue, your hands, your legs, everything that you do, Paul says, don't yield them to unrighteousness. Yield them unto God. What is the old saying that they say a lot of times? I've heard some people say, I don't know if I'm in the Bible, I don't know where the research is. Out of mind is the devil's workshop. Or out of hands is the out of mind, unbelieving, wavering heart. Another way Paul says, James says it when he talks about faith. And he says, if you don't have faith, don't be like the faith is just talking. Don't be like that boat that rides one way 1 minute, and I'm paraphrasing, and rides away the next minute going the other way. You understand what I'm saying? Life is going to throw things at you. People are going to throw things at you. People are going to say things that are going to hurt you. Sometimes church people will say things that hurt you. Your boss will, your spouse will, you take it the wrong way, they didn't mean it that way. It happens. If you have a choice of what you need to do, we've been born again, we have to go by the obligation of the example. Sister Sanders, when they reviled him, when they Pilate took him and they said, "Are you King of the Jews?" They plucked his beard out. I was singing today as I was watching TV. And I got this. I'm not a politician, please. No way. I couldn't tell you how to do it. I just know that sometimes it's good. And I was thinking because they had this lady on TV today, and I won't mention their names, and they said that she was the head of all the protesters. To get people started up at her instinct, and she was just did it, what she did. She could just start a rally at any time. She could just say a few words, and everybody hung on the words, and they could just get riled up real quick. Now, first thing that hit my mind was this. Why don't we as a church get riled up?
Yep, that's the same thing I do. Everybody's amen.
I was saying, why don't we as a church get riled up? Why don't we start protesting?
And you know what the Holy Ghost spoke to me? He said, you don't have to protest. He said, because I'm not. He said, vengeance is mine, saith the Lord.
And I've always wondered why we Christians don't go out and we don't protest. And I've changed my perspective on this thing. If I believe that he is, and don't get me wrong, there are things we need to speak of. But if I believe, Brother Cannon, that he is who he says he is, if I believe that he died and he rose on the third day, and he kept, I don't want to preach my sermon, but I'm feeling it in my heart for Sunday. If he kept his word that far, then he will keep his word for everything else he promised. He will not leave us. He will not forsake us. He knows what's going on. And it's not our job to stand up and get riled up. Because how many of you know if you get in a crowd and the crowd gets in a roar, you're going to be right in there with them. But Paul is saying, don't you yield your members to unrighteousness. Don't you yield your members to those things that are happening. But I'm not saying that there's not things that we don't need to speak up. What I'm saying is that if you can't get in a crowd without getting angry, if you can't go in those situations like that, Paul's saying, you pull back from it and let the Lord do the rest of it. And I'm telling the church that it's not time for us to go and all rallying troops and going around and acting like everything's falling apart. It's time for us really to sit on our four walls and then go out into the community and win the lost as though nothing has changed, because it really hasn't changed. The same God of yesterday, today, and forever is still sitting on the throne, and he knows what's going on, and he will not leave us. So I was watching the news, and I was getting riled up, and the Holy Ghost said, ain't your place to get riled up. You get angry, but don't sin. Jesus is about to come back. Just to give you a quick update, the last three times I have heard President Biden, the last three times he spoke, he has mentioned this four-letter word. Mark of the beast is being put in place. The church is about to leave, because before the Antichrist will be revealed, before the mark of the beast will come, the church of the living God will go up through the clouds to meet the Lord Jesus in the air. And that's how close it is, brothers. That's how close it is, sisters. He's already talking about a tip, and this next tip ain't going to be the tip that you put in your phone. It ain't going to be, I feel the spirit of prophecy in this place. It ain't going to be the tip in the phone. It ain't going to be the tip in the walkie-talkie. It ain't going to be a tip that's put in your car. They're going to try to insert this thing in your hand before you can get on planes, before you can go see your doctors. It's coming, my brothers and sisters. It's coming.
The table is spread, says the Lord. The table is spread. It's about time to dine together, says the Lord. I am coming. Look up and look at redemption is drawing nigh. The table is set, and I am longing for you to join me that where I am, there you may be also, says the Lord. I just want you to stand your feet all over this house and just lift your hands to me. And for the next 30 seconds, if you know somebody that is lost, I want you to pray for them right now. I want you to pray for them right now. You say, preacher, after what the Lord said, I need to pray for them. I need to pray for them. The table is ready. The marriage supper around is close. It's about going home now. And I don't want to see anybody that I lost. And if you feel that way, I don't want you to see anybody that I lost. I want every person on the sound of my voice, if you're praying for that person, to reach out to them sometime before hearing Sunday. Reach out to them. You heard what the Lord God said. You heard what the Lord God said. Jesus, I thank you. Holy Ghost, I thank you. For meeting with us in such a special way. I long for that day, Lord. I long for that day. And when we can join together, sit down with everyone, and most of all, sit down with you. I'm joining with my brothers and sisters in here tonight this Sunday morning. That Lord, you lead us such a way. That Lord, you know how to get a hold of every heart that would be here. Lord, I don't even want to say a word. I would just love for you to think that those are the holes. Praise go with you, people. I love these people. I love these people. And I know you will. Lord, go with them. Help us in every day without you. Help us to go closer to you. As we give you praise and glory. In Jesus' name. Amen. And amen. I encourage you, get on the phone with somebody. Call and invite them, and I would even say to them these words: if you don't come no other time, come Sunday. And I want everybody to be praying fast if you can fast. Let me make this couple of announcements before we dismiss. Easter egg hunt just served at 10 till noon. It'll be kind of cool in the morning, so bring your jacket. Easter Sunday, we will start at 10:30, so there will be no Sunday school, no evening service. We have a special service planned. Also, we might still be here praying with people. How many of you believe we can do it? I believe it. I believe it. I want you to come anticipating.
you that are here on Wednesday night, I call you my co-worker. You're my co-worker. You're the faithful. You're the ones that will only be with it. You will be here. So I have a lot of confidence in your prayers. I want you to pray that the Lord would so anoint me, or the Lord would just take over this service. Pray both ways. That he would just flow in this place, that we can see people, lives, families. Amen. God bless you. I love you. Good to see you again. Good to be back. Love you. Be careful. God bless you.